And MineDojo has three parts, a simulator, a database, and an agent. And here we designed a simulator API to unlock the full potential of the game for AI research. And for example, we want the agent to build a house. And the best way to do it is to learn through data so that the abstract concept of a house can be captured. And next, we collect an internet-scale knowledge base of Minecraft across three parts. And can you believe that someone listed all the thousands of recipes in Minecraft page by page on this wiki? So for our YouTube dataset, we have time-aligned video clips and transcripts. And these are actually real tutorial videos. And now with this time-aligned video and text, we can first train a pair of encoders to map the video and the transcript to the vector space. And then we can train embeddings by contrastive learning, which is essentially pulling together the video and text that match and push apart those that don't match. And this pair of encoder model is what we call the MineCLIP model, based on the idea of CLIP from OpenAI. And intuitively, MineCLIP learns the association between the video and the transcript that describes the action in the video. So let's see MineCLIP in action. Here's an agent. The task is written in natural language. It's called shear sheep to obtain wool. And as the agent explores, it generates a video snippet, which is then encoded and sent to the MineCLIP model to compute a score. And the higher the association is, the higher the score is. And that becomes the reward function to any reinforcement learning algorithm. If this looks familiar to you, that's because it's essentially reinforcement learning from human feedback, or RLHF in Minecraft. And RLHF is the cornerstone algorithm that made ChatGPT possible. And I believe it's also going to play a big role in building generalist agents. And here are some demos of what we learned agent behavior on various tasks. Let's put MineCLIP on the map. It's able to do a lot of tasks, but the limitation is that you have to manually decide a task prompt and then run training every time for a different prompt. And the agent isn't able to discover new things to do. Can we do better? In 2023, when GPT-4 came, a language model that is so good at coding and planning. And so we built Voyager, an agent that massively scales up on a number of skills. And when we set Voyager loose in Minecraft, it's able to play the game for hours on end without any human intervention. And here in this video is a single episode of Voyager, where it explores the terrain, mine all kinds of materials, fight monsters, craft hundreds of recipes, and unlock an ever-expanding tree of skills. And how are we able to do this? So we convert the 3D world into a textual representation, and Voyager invokes GPT-4 to generate a code snippet, and each code snippet is a skill. Voyager isn't always able to get this right on the first try. So we have this self-reflection mechanism, and there are three sources: the JavaScript execution error, the agent state, and the world state. And once a skill becomes mature, Voyager will store the program into a skill library. And you can think of the skill library as a code base, authored entirely by GPT-4 through trial and error. And in the future, when Voyager faces a similar situation, it just retrieves the skill from the code library and executes it. And in this way, Voyager bootstraps its own capability recursively. How does Voyager keep exploring indefinitely? We give Voyager a high-level directive that is to find as many unique items as possible. And then Voyager itself implements a curriculum to find progressively harder and novel challenges to solve. And here are two bird's eye view of the Minecraft map. And the biggest orange circles are the distances that Voyager travels compared to many baseline methods. And because it likes traveling so much, and that's why we give it a name, Voyager. Compared to MineCLIP, Voyager is able to pick up a lot more skills. But still, it only learns how to control one body. So can we scale on a different axis and have a single model that works across different body forms? And that enters MetaMorph. We created a foundation model that works on not just one, but thousands of robots with different arm and leg configurations. And MetaMorph has no problem adapting to extremely varied, you know, physical structures of these robots. So here's the intuition. We develop a vocabulary to describe the robot body parts. And then each part now becomes a sentence written in this language. We can express each kinematic tree into tokens. We can convert those into tokens. And then the sequence by itself as a sentence will describe the morphology and kinematic properties of the robot. You can have different robots that have different numbers of joints and configurations, but the tokenizer doesn't care, right? It's all converted to tokens. So we apply a big fat transformer to control these robots. And this transformer is called MetaMorph. But unlike ChatGPT, which writes out text, MetaMorph writes out motor control for each joint in the body. And because we want to learn a universal policy that works across morphologies, we batch together all the robot sentences and then train a big multitask network. And then we just train these in parallel using reinforcement learning. So we teach the robot to walk through flat terrains, complex terrains, and also navigate obstacles. And in our experiment, we see that MetaMorph can control thousands of different robot forms. And more interestingly, it's able to generalize to robot forms never seen during training. If we expand the robot vocabulary to include more complex configurations, then I envision one day that MetaMorph 2.0 will be able to generalize to robot arms, dogs, different types of humanoids, and even beyond. And compared to Voyager, MetaMorph takes a big stride towards multi-body control, and now it's time to take things to the next level. Enters IsaacSim, NVIDIA's simulation initiative. IsaacSim's greatest strength is to run physics simulation at 1,000 times or even more faster than real time. And this character learns these impressive martial skills by going through 10 years worth of intense training in only 3 days of GPU compute time. And this race car scene here is where simulation has crossed an uncanny valley thanks to hardware-accelerated ray tracing. We can now render very complex worlds with breathtaking levels of details. And the photorealism here can help train computer vision models that will become the eyes of AI agents. Now, what new capabilities can this fantastic new simulation tool unlock? This is Eureka, an agent that achieves robot dexterity at superhuman level. So the idea is IsaacSim has a Python API to construct training environments like this five-finger robot head. The first step of Eureka is to pass the environment code and the task description as context to GPT-4. And the task here is written in natural language to make the hand spin the pen to target positions. And then Eureka samples a reward function. And normally, this reward function is engineered by humans, and actually expert humans who are very familiar with physics simulation. And now, Eureka can automate it. And once we have the reward function, we'll run reinforcement learning to maximize it through lots of trial and error. It only takes 20 minutes to finish a full training run. And putting it together, GPT-4 will generate a bunch of reward function candidates, and each will perform a full reinforcement learning training run. And then Eureka will pass on the automated feedback and ask the language model to self-reflect on the results so it can propose better reward functions to better solve the problem. And rinse and repeat. So compared to expert humans, we actually found that Eureka can even outperform some of the experienced NVIDIA engineers who wrote IsaacSim. The next question is, how do we transfer from the sim to the real world? Here, there's an idea called domain randomization, which is basically the idea that if you train in 10,000 different simulations with different gravity, friction, object weights, and size, and it may very well just generalize to our real world, and we simply ask GPT-4 to also sample the domain randomization configurations. So here on the left-hand side, it's a simulation of the robot dog running forward, and we're able to zero-shot transfer to the real world, and that's a real robot dog also running forward. And this is a hand rotating cubes, and that's a hand rotating cubes in the real world. We did not do the pen spinning in the real world. The hardware is a limiting factor. And this is the most impressive demo we showed. We train a robot dog to walk on a yoga ball in simulation, but we cannot really simulate the bouncy, you know, the deformable yoga ball in sim. So we just randomize and randomize, and Eureka is able to find a very good solution, so we transfer to the real world. And this is my collaborator from UPenn, walking the robot dog there, you know, an episode right out of Black Mirror. And it's worth noting that Eureka is a general purpose method that bridges the gap between high level reasoning and low level motor control. Eureka uses this paradigm that I call hybrid gradient architecture, where an LLM writes a reward function, and that's high level reasoning. And the reward function instructs another smaller neural network using reinforcement learning. And this is the dual loop design. And Dr. Eureka just changes the reward function and add the sim to real configuration. And I envision someday that Eureka++ will be able to just program the task, the embodiment, and even entire simulations for me so that I can go on a vacation someday. And then Eureka++ will do all the development for me, automate the entire robotics pipeline. And then when I come back, I have trained the robots. So in this sense, the Eureka work isn't really a point on the map, but it's a force vector that can push the frontier along any axis because it's a general purpose algorithm that simply does coding. And as we progress through the map, we'll eventually reach a single model that generalizes across all those three axes. And I call that the foundation agent. And I believe training foundation agents will be very similar to ChatGPT. All language tasks can be expressed as languaging, as texting and text out. And ChatGPT simply trains it by scaling it up across lots and lots of text. And very similar here, the foundation agent takes as prompt an embodiment specification and a language instruction, and then it outputs actions. And we simply scale it up massively across lots and lots of realities. In March, Jensen announced Project Root at NVIDIA GTC. The mission is to create a foundation model for humanoid robots. And why humanoid? Because it is the most general purpose form factor. The world is designed around the human form. All our tools, equipments, and houses, restaurants, they're all designed for humans. And in principle, given a good enough humanoid hardware, it should be able to do anything that a reasonably untrained human can do. So we just aim for the most general purpose hardware there. And why do it now? Because we see the manufacturing cost of humanoid robots dropping exponentially over time. In 2001, the NASA humanoid cost north of $1.5 million. And just 2 weeks ago, Unitree announced their G1 robot that will only cost $30,000. And that's roughly the price of a car. And the manufacturing cost of mature products will tend to approach the cost of the raw materials. And here I will quickly show some demo where this is a video instruction. And this is the GR1 robot from Fourier Intelligence imitating the human from a raw video and dancing, and it's able to, you know, keep balance. And this is the group model learning from a human teleoperated demonstration trajectory. And we do cold press juicing. And of course, we'll use simulation, right? Before NVIDIA was an AI company, it was a graphics company. So simulation is actually our stronghold. So we use IsaacSim to run lots of different environments and tasks for the humanoids. And we train different kinds of humanoids in this massively parallel simulation where 3 days of time is equal to 10 years. And we hope that those that are training simulation will transfer to the real world. So back to this question, what makes a cat a cat? The most profound question ever. Well, we don't have any robots that even approach cats in their agility, right? Cats are these embodied agents that are phenomenal in their sensory motor loop. They're so reactive and even faster than humans. And that does so well, right there. So can we have robots someday to be as good as cats? Or even better, can we have humanoid robots pet a cat for you? Yeah, that's a great question. So the cost of humanoids will definitely go down. And as I mentioned in the talk, it's going exponentially down, right? Trending towards the cost of raw materials. So that's number one. Mm-hmm. But actually, I don't really believe that hardware is going to be the bottleneck. I think hardware is not good enough right now, but it will be good enough very soon. And it's improving at an accelerating speed. I think for robotics, the hard part, the bottleneck is actually the AI brain. Because no one has really figured out what's the recipe for foundation agent. I have some ideas on how to do it, but these are all like very early explorations. And even if you have thousands of GPUs to scale up, what do you scale up exactly, right? Like for ChatGPT, you scale up on the text, but for foundation agent, do you scale up on simulation? Do you scale up on lots of internet data? Or do you scale up on human collected teleoperation data on a real robot? It's actually not clear how to do. So I think the AI will be coming the limiting factor. And whoever figures out the AI, or whoever, you know, are the first players who figure out AI, will capture a massive market. So using Jensen's words, I really like his phrasing. He's calling the humanoid robotics a $0 trillion business. It's zero right now, but it will be $1 trillion in the future. And NVIDIA is very, very eager to do $0 trillion businesses. So that's our position.